So today I'm going to talk about visibility and invisibility, finally. And it's all related to the anisotropic case. We started with this topic. So anisotropic case means the conductivity, gamma, depends on direction now. So it is modeled as a positive definite symmetric matrix. So in different directions, electricity is being conducted in different ways. And as I already mentioned earlier, cardiac muscle and general muscle in the human body is highly anisotropic with the, for instance, in this case, the conductivity is much larger in the longitudinal direction than the transversal direction. Okay, so the problem is set up in the same way. So you have a domain in Euclidean space, and you have no sources or sinks of current. The potential satisfies the same equation. This is Ohm's law, which is written more precisely here. It's an equation in divergence form. F is the voltage potential at the boundary, and the isotropic case that we have been discussing in the last three lectures corresponds to the case where this matrix is diagonal, with all the elements in the diagonal the same. So the, in different directions, the conductivity is measured in the same way. By the way, also crystals are highly anisotropic, not just in the human body. Most crystals are exhibit anisotropic behavior. Okay, and the Dirichlet-Neumann map, or the voltage to current map, is the same as before. It looks more complicated now because you have a matrix. These are the components of the mu, is the unit outer normal to the boundary. And the physical meaning is exactly the same. This is the induced current flux at the boundary. And this is the voltage. You're sending the voltage at the boundary to the current at the boundary, or the Dirichlet-Neumann map. So that's it's the same setup that we have earlier. And the question is the same. Can we recover this matrix now in omega from the Dirichlet-Neumann map, from the voltage to current map? Of course, again, these are idealized problems. It's like the Radon transform. You don't have information for all the lines. But if the hope is that if you can solve this problem, and this is the basic question, then you can approximate the conductivity when you have a finite number of measurements. Okay, and the answer is no. And this is, as I mentioned at the end of last talk, there is a large class of non-uniqueness. And is the Dirichlet-Neumann map of the what's called the push forward of the conductivity is the same as the Dirichlet-Neumann map of the conductivity for any change of variables which is identity at the boundary. So as I also mentioned, this is a very large class of non-uniqueness because this is infinite dimensional. The group of diffeomorphies or changes of variable, which is identity at the boundary, is a group. You compose it, it's also change of variables, which is identity at the boundary. It's infinite dimensional. Any rotation inside, for instance, which leaves the boundary fixed, is an example. And then is we have that this is this non-uniqueness, and this push forward means this in terms of matrices is the gradient of psi composed with gamma composed, the Jacobian of psi transpose is the matrix of the differential of psi. This is a map, has n components composed with the matrix composed with the differential itself divided by the determinant. How do you see this? And this is a key also to invisibility. This equation is invariant under changes of coordinates. Most physical equations in come from nature are independent of the coordinate system that you choose. This is the case for the conductivity, Maxwell equation, Helmholtz equation, and so on. Einstein's equations. It shouldn't depend on the change of coordinates that you're looking at. And this is the case. So you see, you take you compose your solution with this change of variables inverse, and you look at the new equation that this satisfies is similar. This is an exercise when the gamma replaced by the push forward here, and then you can see that the Dirichlet Neumann map is the same. Another way to see it, perhaps easier, is the following. We know that we have this quadratic form. In this case, in the case, an isotropic case, can you see this? I try to write large, it's gamma I, the integral over omega gamma ij du dxi du dxj. This is where u solves the equation. This is a matrix again. I'm not going to write it on equation, on omega, and u at the boundary is f. Okay? This is the quadratic form in this case. That's the Dirichlet integral. This is physically the power that you need to maintain the potential f on the boundary. Now you make a change of variables. So psi is a change of variables or a diffeomorphism. It's called a diffeomorphism, which is identity at the boundary. Doesn't change at the boundary. It leaves the boundary point-wise fixed. Then you just use the chain rule here. This is an exercise in calculus. The F remains the same because this is F at the boundary, and the diffeomorphism is the identity at the boundary. So exercise, this is from here, you can easily check. And the determinant that we have here, modulus of the determinant comes because of the change of variables, the Jacobian of the change of variables. Exercise Q of psi is the same as Q gamma of F. Okay. Yes, using the chain rule. And of course, if this is true, this is if and only if the Dirichlet Neumann map are the same. Right? Because the quadratic form, as once more, the quadratic form is equivalent to the Dirichlet Neumann map, like the just integration by parts, the divergence theorem, so ds is surface measure. So this is very simple observation, but it seems that it is good news. It's bad news. It's bad news for the inverse problem, it's good news for invisibility. Okay, as we're going to see. So, but somebody is asking me, how about in practice, what do you do when you have an anisotropic situation? In practice, recover the whole conductivity, the matrix is not, well, it's not feasible. We know that it's not possible. But you also want to recover some features, for instance, discontinuities, or you want to recover, for instance, one eigenvalue of the matrix, the largest eigenvalue, say. some information like that, which is not invariant at the changes of coordinates. Okay? And in most situations in practice, you know something a priori about the, what you're trying to recover. It's not that you're complete in the dark. So if you know something a priori, you might be able to fix this change of variables. But the question is, and this is the conjecture number. Anybody is following this? 5 or 6? No? 6. No, I don't know. Let's say 6. Huh? Certainly it's not this has not been 6. I haven't used the number 6, I know. Okay, so suppose you take gamma anisotropic. Sorry, upper IJ. Gamma IJ is positive definite matrix. Positive definite symmetric matrix. Okay, and again, this is in dimension bigger or equal than 3. I will tell you what's known, but we know very little about this. So you have two of them, let me call it K. Suppose lambda gamma 1 is equal to lambda gamma 2. Is it true that there exists a change of variables, a diffeomorphism? Which is the identity at the boundary. And this is, let's say, smooth. Let's say smooth. Even a smooth case is not a question here of low regularity. Even the smooth case is not known. Is it true that it's a change of variables so that one is the push forward of the other? That's the question. That's the conjecture. Okay. You can do this. You have for sure a paper in the annals. At least, much more than that, but at least that. Okay. And the new ideas are certainly needed for this in dimension 3. In dimension 2, this is known. Even is known for L infinity conductivity. In dimension 2, it's much easier because there are special coordinates called isothermal coordinates that reduces the problem to the isotropic problem. Okay, so that's the homework for you for the summer. Not this week, I will give you more time for the summer. Okay, so let me know what's known. First of all, the two-dimensional case. Let me tell you the results. In dimension 2, we know a lot. So suppose you take even the partial data problem. You take a symmetric, positive definite symmetric matrix. And the Dirichlet number maps restricted to here. So it's a partial data case. For every function supported there, then there is a diffeomorphism. I'm taking here the C infinity case, but it's known for lower regularity. Then there is a diffeomorphism, I call it psi there, here it's called F, so that one matrix is the push forward of the other. And the case of full data was known for different kinds of regularity, and the final result is for L infinity, for full data. This is when gamma is the whole boundary, Astala, Lassas, and Pi Varinta, using the result of Astala Pi Varinta. In two dimensions, you have special coordinates, I'll repeat it again, called isothermal coordinates. So the problem is really like the isotropic problem. It's not really very difficult. Once you have the isotropic case, it's very easy to prove this. I mean, not very easy, but much easier. So in two dimensions, we know this. How about higher dimension? Okay, and I want to point out this because it's really a geometric problem. If you don't know geometry, you don't need to worry about this. You can think of a domain, and again, a positive definite symmetric matrix. A positive definite symmetric matrix, and here the indices are written lower, is called a Riemannian metric, but just a positive definite symmetric matrix. It's a way to measure distances. And you can take even a compact Riemannian manifold with boundary. Again, if you're not familiar with geometry, you can think of a domain in the plane. This is the same. And the Laplace-Beltrami operator, I mentioned this because the invariance plays a big role. Here, this is called the Laplace-Beltrami operator, can be written in coordinates this way. And this will be appearing a lot in invisibility. Is the difference here is the square root of the determinant of G times G upper IJ. Okay, so the conductivity is square root of, this is gamma IJ, is square root of the determinant of G times G upper IJ. G upper IJ is the inverse of the metric G. That's the standard notation. So you can think of conductivities or metrics. This is exactly the same in dimensions 3 or higher. And the Dirichlet-Neumann map in terms of these metrics, so you have what's called the Laplace-Beltrami operator, a harmonic function. If G is the identity, this is the standard Laplacian. And this is the Dirichlet-Neumann map. The only difference is the square root of the determinant of G, but it's exactly as we had before. Why to do this is because it's nice to look at this geometrically. And in these terms, this is in geometry, this is called the conormal derivative. Again, you don't need to worry about that if you don't know this. This is just the expression in coordinates, and it's the current flux. And the problem is a geometric one. Can you recover a Riemannian metric? Again, you can think of a conductivity from the Dirichlet-Neumann map. Don't be afraid of the words. It's just a positive definite symmetric matrix. Well, I'm not going to mention this about string theory. And then in terms of metrics, the question is, can you recover the metric inside? This is a problem that is of interest in its own right. Can you recover from this boundary information about the metric G, the metric inside? And we know that the answer is no. And any change of variables, which is identity at the boundary again, will give rise to a new metric. And here this is called the pullback. Because metrics and conductivities are inverses of each other. So this is the conductivity and the metric are inverses of each other, and the square root has disappeared here. So it's called the pullback. That's just a name. So conductivity is pushed forward. You move them to the other side, and metrics pull back naturally. Okay. And then, the Dirichlet integral is given here, and this is called the volume form for the metric. I don't know why I have the manos here. Maybe it's a manos. No, I don't think it's a manos. Okay, and then, as I said before, you change variables here, and then you can get the invariance and these changes according. It's just a complete, it's writing down in a different language the same thing. Okay, and for dimension 3 or higher, I'm not going to talk more about dimension 2. We prove the conjecture, even in the partial data case, this conjecture here, 6, with Matti Lassas, and we had a better proof with Michael Taylor, that in the real analytic case, if the matrix are real analytic, and if the Dirichlet normal maps are the same, for functions supported at the same, that in the change of variable, which is the identity in the set where you have the data, so that one metric is the pull back of the other. So we know this conjecture in the real analytic case, not in the smooth case. And for the people who are interested in these kind of things, not only you can, this is for manifolds, not only you can recover the metric, but you can also recover the topology. You can have holes, handles, many things. You only need to know the information at the boundary, the Dirichlet Neumann map and the boundary, and then you can recover everything about the inside. But this is assuming that it's real analytic, which is a strong assumption, very strong assumption. The smooth case, we don't know. This is a very interesting problem, and I hope I don't take it to my tomb. I want to see how to solve it. I have worked on this problem for many years without solving it. And I have offered $1,000. I don't have $1 million to offer, like the clay prize, to somebody who solves this problem. When I offered this some time ago in Sweden, in the lecture I gave in Sweden, and somebody asked me, is $1,000 for every dimension? No, for all dimensions. Or dimension three, which is the interesting case. If you solve it for dimension five, it's not so interesting. Dimension three or all dimensions? And to be more precise, I don't want to pay $1,000 times infinity. Okay. Okay, so there is a case where you can get, as I said before, if you know something about the metric a priori, you might be able to recover. And this is the case in the conformal. It's again conjecture in the conformal class. What does it mean, this? Suppose you have a metric G, again, you can think of a conductivity, and you take a multiple of it, a scalar multiple of it, and the Dirichlet Neumann maps are the same. Is it true that they are the same? In this case, there is no diffeomorphism acting there, because when you do this change of variables that we had before, when you do this change of variables, this new conductivity or metric is not going to be in the same conformal class. It's not going to be a multiple of the metric because you have the Jacobian here. So you can hope to have them equal. And this is the case where we have been considering when G is the identity metric, this is the conductivity, isotropic conductivity. And we reduce it to the potential, and you can do the same thing here. You can reduce it to the potential problem. So this is now a different Laplacian. It's not the standard Laplacian. It's the one I wrote here before. It's called the Laplace-Beltrami operator, which is invariant, this one. In the case that you have the identity, this is what we considered before, Laplacian minus Q, but you can consider a more general Laplacian. And this is the other inverse problem, which is a special, if you can solve this, you can solve that, but let me write it as problem 7, which is easier problem. Even that we don't know how to do in dimension 3 or higher. So let me put conjecture 7. Okay. Again, it's in dimension bigger or equal than 3. In dimension 2, we know this. Suppose G, again, I wrote it as is a positive definite symmetric matrix. You can think in conductivity, square root of the determinant of G times G upper ij, where G upper ij is the inverse of the metric G. You see, you don't want to think about metrics. On omega, this is also posed on a manifold, but let me say on a domain. Suppose you take a multiple of it, and beta is a smooth function, let's say smooth, strictly positive on omega. So you take a multiple. This is a matrix. You take a multiple of it. This is the isotropic conductivity is an example. This is more general. Does this implies beta equal to 1? Implies beta equal to 1. That's a conjecture. And also, more generally, you have you fix the metric G and you take a potential Q, even a smooth case. Let's take a smooth, L infinity is the natural question. And suppose you take two potentials, so let me put Q, K. K equal 1 to 2. And suppose the Dirichlet Neumann mass for the potentials is the same. That this implies Q1 equal to Q2. This is for the Dirichlet, you're talking about the Laplace-Beltrami operator minus QK. This is solution of this equation, right? The G is fixed, the potentials are not. You have two potentials. You have a more general operator, and use F on the boundary. You can define the Dirichlet Neumann map as before. Is it true that the potentials are the same? Of course, if you solve this, you solve this. So these are very interesting. There are a lot of open problems here to think about. And this has been done in dimension 2. There are many results, so I'm not going to talk about this. This is known in dimension 2. In dimension 3 or higher, which is the case of interest, there are some special cases where we know this result. For when the metric is a multiple of a metric which is 1 here, and is a metric independent of one of the coordinates on the other variable. So you can split the coordinates into Euclidean one. This is x1 squared, say. This is identity here, 1, and then it can be arbitrary in this direction. And then in this case, we know. Well, we know this condition has been removed. So in this case, we essentially know it. But besides that, this is called invisible geometries. These are very special geometries. Includes the case that we know, the Euclidean metric, when this is the case that we already did, with the hyperbolic metric, for the people who know the metric in the sphere, minus a point. It's included here on these examples, and there are many other examples, but this is very special still. And the general case, we don't know. Okay, so now this is what's known. The final topic, and I will take more time than So to finish this, and then in the afternoon you're free. Okay, so that's the trade-off. It's about invisibility. So what is the idea? We couldn't solve the problem, right? We were working on this problem, this conjecture, and we couldn't solve it, and then we realized that there are conductivities for which this is not true. However, it doesn't violate the conjecture because this is not going to be strictly positive definite. And the idea is very simple. The idea that we have is related to singularities of manifolds. That's why I mentioned manifolds. Suppose you have this drum bell here. This is an example of what's called a catenoid. And suppose you pinch, this is the boundary here. This part is the boundary of the manifold. It's a drum bell. And suppose you pinch this all the way. You pinch it. So when this bridge gets narrower and narrower, less information goes through here. And eventually, if you pinch it all the way, nothing will go through. So this part of the manifold is going to be completely invisible. Okay. So that's what we have. This is, of course, for a very abstract manifold and all that. You pinch this all the way. You're only making measurements here. Since this is pinched, nothing goes through. Nothing. Even for the elliptic problem, the currents are not going to go through. That's the idea. We have to realize this in practice. So for the last hour or so, or maybe less, I will give you my standard talk on invisibility. Some of you have heard it before, but it's fun, so let's, we can, so we'll try it. So we'll talk about invisibility. But started with this conjecture. We were trying to solve this problem, and we realized there are some conductivities for which it's not true. However, they are not positive definite. That condition is violated. Okay, so let's see. How do I get out here? Where is the keyboard? How do I get out? Must be a keyboard. Oh, here it is. Okay, so this is a lecture I gave somewhere in Ann Arbor. The one I have prepared for here, the movies didn't work, so I had to use a previous one that worked. Okay. So it's called Harry Potter's Clock via Transformation Optics. So let me start with the movie. It started with Simba's problem, so it's natural to... I also will show this in my public lecture next week. Okay, so invisibility is coming. Okay, so the first clip that you saw is from H.G. Wells, based on the novel by H.G. Wells, Invisible Man. So he makes himself invisible by a chemical procedure that changes his index of refraction to make the same as of air. So the rays of light will go straight through. The way this, why you see something, when you see something, you are looking at the reflection of light in your eyes, in the retina of your eyes. But if the rays of light don't reflect, then you don't see anything. That's the idea. You see because of reflection, scattering, or something like that about light. Light scatters, reflects, refracts, and so on. But if there is no such thing, then the rays of light will go straight through, and you don't see. You see the clothes because the clothes have not changed the index of refraction. I was at the Museum of Science yesterday in Singapore. They have a very nice museum here with my grandson, and they have a mirror exhibit, which the kinds of things that you can do with mirror, because the way you see is reflections. And there are examples of this on invisibility. Magicians do it all the time. You put mirrors in special places, and you don't see half of your body. You don't see, or you can see whatever you want. You can do many things because of this principle that you only see. The way we see it is by reflection, mainly reflection or scattering of light in our eyes. However, don't try this because it's very dangerous, and the invisible man tried to change it. And then, of course, it didn't work out. My son, who lives in Singapore, he mentioned to me when I told him about the ideas for invisibility, about the invisible woman, it does something very similar, which is the following. You saw the clip. She creates a field of energy around her, some shield of energy. We're not told how. Okay, that's the problem. That deflects light. The light will not reflect from her, will go around her. And this is from the comic. He's a comic fanatic, so he knows all about comics. I think the Fantastic Four. It's from the Fantastic Four. So she deflects light. And this is a very good idea also. To change the index of refraction is a good idea, but how to do it? And then the Star Trek has a much more scientific idea of how to do this, what the invisible woman does, which is to deflect light. You want to deflect light so that you are invisible, which is they put gravitons. Gravitons are hypothetical elements in relativity, which has infinite gravitation. So that by the Einstein's theory of relativity, you have a very strong gravitational field, light will be deflected. So because of that, they put the gravitons on. Well, of course, again, how do you get the gravitons? And light will be deflected, and when you want to become visible, they turn the gravitons off. Well, very nice idea, and this is the first analogy with relativity. There is an analogy between the ideas for cloaking and invisibility. Okay, and this is accomplished. One way to accomplish this is a la Harry Potter. So Harry Potter has a cloak. And the cloak has the following function. First of all, the index of refraction is changed in the cloak. So it's a material, built of a material. You don't change your index of refraction, but you put a material that has a different index of refraction So the light will be deflected like the invisible woman. So this is the principle, and I will show you how to do it in theory. And there has been some progress in the application. This is me half invisible, and you can see Maxwell equations. Can you see it? Yeah, on the background. And the Maxwell equations is propagation of light, right? This is another one, my hand invisible. Okay, so the method that has been proposed is called transformation optics. Transformation comes from changes of variables, transformations. And this is the method that has been the most successful so far. And it's very simple and it's very mathematical. There were two articles in Science that attracted a lot of attention by Penry et al., Controlling Electromagnetic Fields, and a related article by Ulf Leonhard in the same issue of Science, Optical Conformal Mapping. But this is, Leonhard's is in two dimensions, and he uses conformal maps as transformations. This is more general. But there was an earlier article of Greenleaf, Lassus, and myself, non-uniqueness for Calderon's problem. So there you are, that we were discussing Calderon's problem that uses transformations. In fact, we use exactly the same transformation as Penry et al., exactly the same. So the same idea. And Science magazine has a very good description of this transformation optics, the ultimate camouflage. Says the real breakthrough may lie in the theoretical tools used to make the clock. Harry Potter, we want to build the clock. In such transformation optics, researchers imagine a la Einstein. So this is, again, an analogy with relativity, warping empty space. So in relativity, The metric warps space. The metric, which corresponds to gravitation, warps space around. That's the fundamental idea of Einstein, geometric idea. So light will be deflected by a strong gravitational field. Space will be warped. That's what was used in Star Trek when they were making the ship invisible. Mathematical transformation then tells them how to mimic the bending by filling and warp space with a material whose optical properties vary from point to point. So this corresponds to changing the index of refraction, building a material with an index of refraction. The technique could be used for many things, antennas and so on. Anyway, you look at it, the ideas behind invisibility are likely to cast a long shadow. You don't want shadow. In invisibility, you don't want shadow because you have a shadow, you can tell something about the object, not shadow. That's part. And invisibility also means from every possible direction. You make the object invisible from any possible direction. If you look at the mirrors that magicians use, it's only in a particular direction that you will be invisible. If you go somewhere else, you are not going to be invisible because it's the mirrors. Okay, so this is a cartoon from the paper of Penry et al. This is a section of the cloak. The blue part is the cloak. And in the ball of radius R1 is Harry Potter, the orange part. So the rays of light will come in a straight line here, they hit the clock, they bend around. And so when you look outside the clock and the boundary here or outside, it looks like the rays of light went straight through, like in the case of the invisible man. So this is what we want to do, to achieve invisibility. So what we did with Greenleaf and Lassus was to build currents so that they will do the same. Currents are the solutions of the equation, right? The potential is related to the solutions of the equation. So on the left, If the material has conductivity 1 or a constant, the currents go straight through, the traveling straight line. We build conductivities so that the currents will go around, like in the case what we want to do. But when you observe it on the boundary of this region, it looks like same as on the left. You cannot distinguish between the picture in the right and the left, so everything that you put inside here is invisible. So that's the way to achieve invisibility. So I will explain how to build these conductivities. And once you do that, you can do the same for Helmholtz equation, for Maxwell equations, and many other things. Okay, so the analogy with relativity is you want to bend light. Again, if you have a strong gravitational field like the sun, when you see a star, it's not in the place where it is because it has been deflected by light, by the sun, by a strong gravitational field. It's called gravitational lensing. An extreme phenomenon of that is, here is the expert, on black holes. When you have a very strong gravitational field, light will be trapped. This is called the event horizon. After it crosses here, it cannot escape. So it's a black hole. And we want to build is an optical, not a gravitational one, for light, that the rays of light will go around, or not only the rays of light, the waves will go around and be deflected, and this object will be invisible. Okay, so there are, what is light has also been of interest to humans for a long time, besides invisibility. The ray theory of light is based on Fermat's principle that light will try to go from point A to point B in the minimum amount of time possible. So this corresponds to what's called the optical length. The length of this path has to be the minimum with respect to the index of refraction. So you have to try to go from point A to point B in the minimum amount of time, but that depends on the index of refraction, because the index of refraction is the inverse of the speed of light in the medium. So this is varying from very small index of refraction to very high, so the rays of light will curve. Not go in a straight line, that will be in the case that the index of refraction will be 1, we will bend. Right? That's the ray theory of light. And it's varying continuously, so the rays of light will bend continuously here. Of course, we know that rays can break if the index of refraction is different. If air is water, you have a similar situation as you have with the star, although this is not smooth. This is broken. Then to go from point A to point B in the minimum amount of time possible, it's easy to show, it's a calculus problem, that the minimum amount of time will be a path that will be like this, break. And Snell's law will be satisfied. So the fish is in a position, when you see the fish, it's not where it is. It's the same as a star, it's not where it is. And this is a familiar phenomenon that you can see explains this, the Fermat theory explains this, that when you in a glass of water, the straw looks broken, but it's not broken, it's just an illusion. Okay, and this index of refraction where the varies continuously, this is what you want. This is when a smooth deflection happens in the desert, for instance, very hot surfaces. I'm sure you can see this in Singapore, where it's very hot. And when you are driving, sometimes you see patches of water in the road that are not there. Because what you are seeing is the reflection of light, you're seeing the sky, not the water. It's another illusion. This is a mirage. Okay, but the question is whether the waves will do this. Can we do this just not for the rays of light, but for the waves? And then you can. And we are going to see this also. So the wave theory of light, of course, the ray theory of light explains many things, but some, not everything. For instance, diffraction. You have a diffraction by a corner or things like that, they're not explained by the ray theory of light. The wave theory of light is much more complete and explains many things that have had tremendous applications. If you want to display mathematics, it was mathematics and physics that was theory in the 19th century, has the most applications is Maxwell equations. Everything that you have, your phone, is amazing. It comes from Maxwell equations. So the observation that light is an electromagnetic wave. You have the electric field and the magnetic field, and these are the electromagnetic parameters, epsilon and mu, and the index of refraction, which is important in the ray theory of light, is the square root of epsilon times mu. So Maxwell must have been ecstatic when he discovered that the propagation of the speed of propagation of light is this, square root of epsilon times mu. Okay, and this is the wave theory of light. I don't need to tell you, this is for a lecture. This is for time harmonic waves. This is the frequency k. And the frequency will play a role. So change in the electric field produces a magnetic field and vice versa. This is electric displacement, this is magnetic displacement. And again, the square root of epsilon times mu is the index of refraction. Okay, so what we are going to do is again related to geometry of Maxwell equations or the conductivity equation, is that these equations are invariants and the changes of coordinates. If you change coordinates, the equation will look exactly the same as this. Of course, the E and the H will change, but they will be of the same form. The conductivity equation, you change variable, it changes the conductivity, but the equation does not change, the form of the equation. And look at this. This is what we saw before. This is G upper ij square root determinant of G. So the epsilon and the mu, this is going to be anisotropic materials. The cloak will be formed by anisotropic materials. And it's exactly what we had previously for the conductivity, square root determinant of G times G upper ij from the previous lecture. Today, late. And this is, of course, similar what happens for Helmholtz equation, and this is again once more the Laplace-Beltrami operator. Look at this square root, which I mentioned it already, the determinant of G times G R per J. So this is what comes here. It's the same in every single case where transformation optics has been used. The geometry plays a role, and the coefficients are of this form. Okay, so Helmholtz equation, and then the static case that we have been looking at is when these are decoupled, and these are harmonic functions, and this is Calderon's problem. I'm not going to repeat all of this because we already had several lectures on this. I'm curious to know where the movie works here. Let's see. Do I have the movie, the fish? No, I don't have it. No. Okay, and this is the idea of transformation optics. Okay, so let me explain something first. We have this, let me erase this. We had invariance already under changes of variables. So you ask the question, why is not just invisibility? Suppose you take conductivity 1, gamma 1 equal to 1. It's isotropic, it's identity. And you take gamma 2 to be the push forward of 1 by change of variables. Any change of variables will do. Right? We have a lambda gamma 1, the Dirichlet Neumann map is lambda gamma 2. And this encodes all the measurements, electrical measurements that you can make at the boundary. So why is not invisibility? You have an homogeneous medium, the current goes straight through, and then you change it, and you get the same non-uniqueness. Why is this not what we want? The reason is that if you are Harry Potter and you want to make yourself invisible, here in this ball, say, the conductivity here must be arbitrary. You want to clock everything here. Here, the conductivity has to be arbitrary, right? But this will produce a very specific conductivity. It's not going to be arbitrary. If you want to have an arbitrary one, you have to take all the changes of variables, but that's impossible. So you take a particular change of variables. This is going to be a very special one inside here. So you want to have something different, and this is the idea of pinching the manifold. So how do you do this? This is the transformation optics. So this is physical space here on the right, the picture on the right. This is the ball, and then you want to clock the fish. It would be better to have a picture of Harry Potter, but I don't know how to do that. You want to clock this blue fish here. And you want to make the rays of light bend. So what we're going to do, this is virtual space. What we're going to do is blow up this point to a ball. Make a transformation that this will be transformed into this ball here. Or the other way around, you can collapse this ball to a point. This is the transformation. Why this? Why a point? Because a point in a space, or in two dimensions, is invisible. You cannot see a point. Since the laws of physics are the same and the transformations, this ball corresponds to a point, so everything you put in here should be invisible. That's the idea, very simple idea of transformation optics. And you can see here in the coordinate system here, you can think of this as the rays of light. And here, when you do this transformation, they are bent. That's what we want to do, right? And this is, hope this movie works. Oops, sorry. It works. So it is a point that being transformed into this ball, and you can see how the rays of light are being curved around the optical, around the object. That's all the idea of transformation optics, blowing up a point to a ball. Sorry? Just change of coordinates. That's it. That's transformation optics. As I already told him, invisibility is much easier than visibility. To find something is much harder than to make it, to hide it. Okay, how to do this? And again, by the way, this is much more general. This is a ball. This is a point. You can take any object, any shape. Doesn't have to be a ball. Of course, in the case of a ball, we can write down the exchange of variables. You can collapse any shape to the point. And why a point? Because a point is invisible. But in three dimensions, any curve will be invisible. Not in two dimensions, but in three dimensions, a curve, a line is invisible. You cannot see a line. So you can also, and we're going to use that later, you can make a, you can blow up a line or a curve. We're going to, and you can, mathematically, this is what's called a removable singularity for the equation. Any set, this is, you don't need to know the, what means necessarily, but any set of Hausdorff dimension less or equal than one will work in dimension three. So this is, you can write this, the change of variables. It's written here. This is the change of variables that Penry et al., Penry and co-authors use, the same. Exactly the same, not even a slight difference. So blows up a point to this. This is a change of variables, of course, and you have, this is blowing up the point, and this is collapsing this to the point. That's it, that's all the idea. There is one difference with the paper of Penry. They call this domain the ball of radius R2, and this is the ball of radius R1, and we call it 2 and 1. Besides that, it's not different. And this is, you can write it down. So you will know what is the conductivity or even the electromagnetic parameters of the clock. You take the identity, and then you take the push forward, or you can take the metric, which remember is the inverse times the determinant, and the spherical coordinates is this. You're away from theta when the sign is zero. But notice the following. This is very important. This is an anisotropic conductivity. It's different conductivity, it's diagonal. However, in the radius of the clock, here, the radius of this is the ball of radius 1. This is 0 of order 1. So it's not, doesn't violate this conjecture because it's not positive definite, it's a semi-positive definite. It has a 0 of order 1 at the boundary of the clock in the radial direction. In terms of metrics, remember the metric is the inverse of the conductivity, it's blowing up. So this is similar to black holes. Yeah, that's the event horizon, exactly. That's the analogy with relativity. And the theorem, you had to prove this because you had to define what the Dirichlet-Neumann map is for this because it's not, it's degenerate. It has a zero. That's what we proved, that the Dirichlet-Neumann map is the same. Of course, Penry et al. Didn't prove anything. Is the same. The matrix for the metric is the same. And notice that inside the clock, the conductivity is arbitrary. This is something that you want. Here is arbitrary. The conductivity or the metrics are arbitrary there. Okay, there is another, so the metric is singular, but you can regularize it. I want to mention later. I mean, this is singular. How to build this is a problem. This is the theory. And this is the way we obtain this picture I showed you at the beginning. You have the conductivity of the clock. You know the material that you need to put here to achieve this, that the currents will go around. And when you observe it on the boundary or away from the boundary, it's exactly the same as conductivity one. And you can do now this for any equation that is embedded on the changes of coordinates, for instance, Helmholtz equation. You take the Laplace-Beltrami operator. Now you have the frequency is not zero anymore, plus k squared. This corresponds to the acoustic clock, the acoustic equation. The physical meaning is not anymore conductivity, but notice it's the same type. Square root of the determinant of G times G upper IJ. Here, it's the same. This is the density, it's an anisotropic density. And the bulk modulus is the square root of the inverse of the square root of the determinant. And you can do exactly the same, the metric is this, exactly as before. And the theorem is that the Dirichlet-Neumann map is the same as the identity one. So you have accomplished, theoretically for the moment, I will talk about the applications soon, acoustic clocking. So you can have a perfect concert hall. Here is your concert hall. The acoustic waves will go around. They don't penetrate here, and whatever is inside is not going to go outside. And some physicists realized also this, called the acoustic clocking, Shen and Chan, and this is authors here. But it's the same thing. It's exactly the same thing. There's no difference.
Times x over x. Yeah. So when x is very large, so
but this x is not large, it's bounded between it's bounded by 2. Yeah. It's 0, the problem is 0. This transformation is singular at 0. It's a diffeomorphism away from the 0. It blows up a point.
The point to the circle.
Yeah, right. But that's singular.
Right.
It has to be singular, right? It cannot be, because a point cannot be the same as the...
Oh, I see. But actually, after the reading of all, this is, let's say, after I equals 2, how to do the green or how to do...
You can do this for any shape, for any large x. Of course, the transformation is not going to be exactly the same as this, because you want this to be the identity at the boundary.
Right.
You can also do it for a scattering, if you are interested in a scattering. You want to do it at infinity. Yeah, you can do that. The scattering is the same. Yeah. The boundaries are equal to 2, the radius 2.
Yeah.
And it has to be the identity, the change of variable has to be the identity at the boundary.
Right. I'm worried about the gluing. So for example, we know that we replace the disk 2 by changing this.
By what?
So we have a point here.
Yeah.
The
normal derivative of the diffeomorphism is also the identity in this case. It's exactly the same also.
Okay.
Okay, and then you can play the same game for Maxwell equations. Of course, this is a first order system. This is the interest of this is, of course, you want to do this for light. This is the next step. And then, look, I already mentioned this is exactly the same as before. It's G inverse times square root, exactly the same parameters. And this is the ones you're going to put here. And inside the clock is arbitrary metric, positive definite metric. And the theorem, again, is that the Dirichlet-Neumann maps are the same. What is the Dirichlet-Neumann map in this case? Is you're sending the normal component of the electric field to the normal component of the magnetic field. It's a little bit different, but here it is written down. Sorry, the tangential component. Yeah, so the norm. Tangential component of the magnetic, the electric field to the tangential component of the magnetic field. And that's the theorem. So you can have light. And you can play this game with, and there has been many papers in the physics literature about doing exactly the same for different type of equations. Any equation that's invariant in the transformations, this will work. The same game will work. And you can write it down explicitly, again, the epsilon and the mu in terms of these coordinates, the spherical coordinates is here in terms of the radius. Of course, as you can see, I'm writing it in terms of what Penry et al. Did, but it's the same. These are non-singulars in this angular direction, but they are singular in the radial direction. And you achieve what we wanted for the conductivity, the currents go around, and for light goes around. Because for Maxwell equations, it's light, propagation of light. And that's an extremely simple idea, and this is a simulation based on this work, not for the waves, not the rays. So this is a particular direction that the waves come, plane waves, but you can do it in every direction. They go around, and then when you measure on the other side, you get exactly the same. And there are other proposals using this type of idea. This is not a complete clocking, but it's very similar, which is what you do when you want to put, when you want to hide something, you don't want people to see something, you put it under the carpet. So instead of doing this transformation, you flatten this to make it a plane. So in some directions it's not clocking, but it's very similar. And you can do this for many things. You can transform an object into another one. This was observed by the physicists and by Hongyu Liu, here advisor in the mathematical literature. So I can transform myself into, I can be seen, it's an illusion, it's not reality, into George Clooney. Okay, there is a problem with this method. I mean, this is perfect invisibility. There is an issue, which is that the materials that you have to build are singular at the boundary of the clock. So how to solve that? Well, this is approximate clocking, and there are two main ideas that have been tried out for this. One is truncation. That was the first idea, and both of them are equivalent, in fact. So you have the radius 2, and here is the radius 1, where the clocking takes place. You go a little bit more than the radius 1, and you take the conductivity that we know will deflect light here, which is non-singular. It's only singular at the boundary of the clock. So here you go a little bit away from the boundary of the clock, and then here you put anything, an arbitrary conductivity. You don't have perfect clocking anymore, but you have approximate clocking. That means the new conductivity, gamma epsilon, which is just a truncation from the previous one, is L infinity, it's bounded, it's not smooth. But doesn't matter for clocking. It goes to the Dirichlet Neumann map of 1, and we know the rate that it goes. It's not just a convergence result, as epsilon goes to 0. And this is approximate clocking, and from the point of view of clocking, that's good enough. Why? Because you can see up to a certain precision, so a conductivity sufficiently close to here will be good enough for clocking. Okay. And now this new conductivity, gamma epsilon, is not singular anymore. It's a strictly positive definite. Right? So that's the idea, and this has been regeneralized in many ways. the truncation method. There is another method, which is making a you take a tiny ball here and you map it to the clock. So you do this transformation. You take a small ball and you blow it up. You make it larger to the ball where Harry Potter is. And this is non-singular now because it's not a point. And then you let the radius of this ball go to zero. And then you get approximate clocking. And it has been shown by Hongyu Liu, actually, that the two methods are equivalent. And there are many results extending this to Maxwell equation, Helmholtz equation. And this is the blow up by a small ball for conductivity first, and then they did it for Helmholtz equation in this paper. There has been many works in this direction. This is just a partial list. Okay, and now, let's see, I plan to go until 12. Do I have time? So this afternoon there is no session. Since I'm going further, you are free. unless you want to have some. Okay, how about the question of, it's true that Harry Potter is invisible, but also he cannot see anything. Right? So he's completely in the dark. Because nothing goes, he's invisible, but also he cannot see anything. So how to solve that problem? And then there is an interesting, very interesting paper of Halu and Guetta, and we did the mathematics of this, which is to put a sensor inside, because for approximate clocking, which is the one you want in practice, right, because it's non-singular, a little bit of the wave goes inside. You don't see it because you can only see up to certain precision, but there is a little bit that goes inside. So the idea is to put a sensor inside that will be invisible, but will magnify the wave, will make it larger, right? It's like magnifying glass. A little bit goes in, you magnify it, but only inside. You don't see it from the outside. So these are called invisible sensors, and the way to do this, so this is the clock. You put a sensor here, and you put the roving condition in this. This is the roving condition, the normal derivative plus alpha u in this sensor. Okay, and then depending on this coefficient alpha, this is called roving condition. There are several modes. Let's see, this is what happens in general. That the wave will still be invisible. So nothing happens there in that case. So only particular values of alpha will be good. So this, again, this is invisible, so still he's in the dark. This is the one we're interested in. There is for some values of alpha, and we can compute them. So the wave goes in, and then it gets magnified. And there is another interesting case that may have other applications. We have other applications of this for this, but I'm not going to mention them here, where you have absolute trapping. It gets trapped inside. It's like a black hole. So the wave gets trapped and doesn't go out. Oh, that's the sensor mode, sorry. This is the trapping mode. Goes inside and then doesn't come out. Okay. So that's the theory. How about the practice? So there are materials called metamaterials that have, it's a generic name, beyond materials, that corresponds to materials that have not been found in nature that have special properties. One of them is invisibility, but there are others. There are photonic crystals and many other type of materials. And here in Singapore, you have several centers of metamaterials, right, in this university, not right? And this is a very interesting new, relatively new area where you create these materials artificially that cannot be found in nature. You cannot find things that make things invisible in nature because they will be invisible anyway. You cannot see them. This is just a joke. And Davis, the first experiments on clocking were done by the first successful one, David Smith and others. This was based on the theory. They built these materials formed by these circuits. It's called slit ring resonators, here in layers, whose conductivity, electric permeability, and so magnetic permeability and electric permittivity were the ones close to the ones that we know from the theory that will give you clocking. And they have in YouTube, they have this. I showed you the movie before, a plane wave coming in. They have a wave coming in, and then it was clocked. But this was done at microwave frequencies. So here, the reason why I wrote the Maxwell equations in terms of frequencies because the materials depend on frequency. This is one of the main problems. The higher the frequency, they're built at wavelengths. Wavelengths is the inverse of the frequency. The smaller the larger the frequency, the smaller the wavelengths, the harder it is to build the materials. That's why it has been hard for light. And the first experiment for light were for two-dimensional structures by these authors. But there have been others, and for light, I will mention something about light. It's getting, there have been a lot of progress. Many experiments have been doing around the world for very small objects, not yet at the size, for instance, that this was done. This was done for a large, I think it was 12 centimeter long cylinder of copper. Copper is very highly conducting. Another proposal has been done. You cannot do experiment with black holes, but you can build black holes artificially for light, optical black holes. Is the opposite of what we did. We bend the light around. Here is you want to trap light so it doesn't come out. And this was done actually by these Chinese authors. And there have been several other groups that have done this to do experiments in the laboratory about black holes. The most progress has been for acoustic clocking. So that's the sound of silence. So for a perfect concert hall. So Shang, I don't remember his, Shang is a very common name in China, of course. I don't remember his first name. He used to be at Berkeley, he had a very successful laboratory at Berkeley, and now he's the president of Hong Kong University. University of Hong Kong. Very surprising that he became an administrator. And so these are built from very simple materials, plastic, and putting holes in special places. You can make sound waves go around. Now, perhaps this will be the first applications of clocking. I don't know. There are some experiments. Have been also proposed for water clocking, water waves. It's called tsunami clocking. Again, it's very similar to the construction you had before in layers with pillars here so that the water will go around and not penetrate here. And laboratory experiments have been done by these authors. And the reason why this works is because the equations are invariant the changes of coordinates. Of course, It has not been done at the scale of a tsunami, but it has. This is a name that doesn't correspond to what has been done, but that's the idea, to make water go around. And an application that interests me a lot is because I come from a country with a lot of earthquakes, is whether you can do this for seismic waves. So you can build materials that will make these waves go around, seismic waves, go around and not destroy buildings. And of course, this has not been done at that level. Again, there has been experiments on seismic metamaterials by these authors rather recently. And this is not as difficult as light because the frequency is much lower. The frequency of seismic waves is much lower. And of course, there is a lot to be done, and the mathematics of this, not much has been done. It's an interesting subject. Okay, so let me finish. I have 5 minutes. I was going to finish at 12. Sorry to go more time, but then you don't have the afternoon. We're going to do another analogy with relativity, which is wormholes. Wormholes are predicted by the general theory of relativity as a shortcut in space-time. They have not been found. So you want to go from one, you want to go to the future. I don't think you can go to the past, but you can go to the future through a wormhole. You go to the past, you change the future, right? So instead of going this way, you go through a wormhole. Of course, this is had been attracted also a lot of fiction and so on. But we can do a similar thing for electromagnetic waves. And the idea is to, so you want to construct a device that functions like a wormhole for electromagnetic fields. The idea will be not to blow up a point to make things invisible, but to blow up a line. This is what I... So you're tricking the waves to go this way when they're going straight through. So this is the way we propose. So you blow up a line. So how do you... And this is in 3 dimensions, not in 2 dimensions. You blow up a line, it's a cylinder. So this part of the cylinder will be cloaked. So you don't see anything here, you don't see this part, but you will see what's coming in, and you can, because you can put something arbitrary inside, you can put any electromagnetic parameters inside. Here, you can encode what comes out. So you are creating a secret code between 2 different points in space. So this is ray trace simulations. So for this part, the rays of light go around, like for clocking. So this is completely invisible. You have a cylinder, it can be as long as you want. You can, it doesn't have to be the shape of a cylinder, you can have other shapes. You don't need to blow up a line, you can blow up a curve. This part is invisible. And the rays inside, you can do whatever you want. You can create any phenomenon that you like, any code that you like. Can wiggle around a lot, can go back. You send something and go back, all of a sudden goes back. You can trap it inside too. You can have a trapping metric here inside. Because the metric inside here or the electromagnetic parameters are arbitrary. This is a ray trace simulation. Depends on the metric that you put inside. So this is, we don't have simulations for a real gravitational wormhole, but you can do it for electromagnetic wormhole depends on the metric inside. So an end on the worm is a sphere, the other end is over an infinite chessboard and under the blue sky. And you can see the different effects that you can create here depending on the metric that you put inside. This is the same picture. Okay, and there has been experiments recently. It took very little time from the theory to the experiments to do a magnetic wormhole. So magnetic wormhole was built in the laboratory for a magnetic field. You put here a magnetic field here, and something comes out on the other side. So whatever is in the middle, you don't see it by these authors. And what to do with a wormhole? This is was in Nature News, but you cannot read it here, so I wrote it here. And since I'm running out of time, let me mention just two things. A three-dimensional video displays. The cables will be completely invisible. The video will be completely invisible. So light will come. You know what you're putting in, and then you only see what's coming out. All the cables are invisible. You can have a visual magnetic monopole. This is what has been created. Have a magnetic field here. Of course, we don't have magnetic monopoles, and then a magnetic field comes out. You don't see anything in between. In between is completely invisible to magnetic fields. You can do scopes for MRI. Magnetic resonance imaging uses strong magnetic fields. However, you cannot do operations and use magnetic resonance images to see what is inside, because all the instruments will fly. It's a strong magnetic field, so you can put them in an electromagnetic wormhole. Of course, these are future, maybe your children or your grandchildren will see this, I don't know. There will be other applications, I'm sure. Who would have thought about cellular phones just 30 years ago? And an amusing application was proposed by these authors. You can have bifocals, not by us. Bifocals, the front, the top is the regular one, you can see in front. The other ones are attached to electromagnetic wormholes, two electromagnetic wormholes here. These are invisible, but you can see everything that is in your back, because, well, you know, whatever comes in, you can see it. So it's very useful for some people to be able to watch your back without looking, right? Okay, so the question is asked whether you can do the, we will be able to buy Harry Potter's cloak in the near future. I don't know. Who can predict the future? Who will have been able to predict cellular phones? This iPhone has more power than all the computers 50 years ago. And Arthur Clarke says, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. And then it's a question of using your imagination. You are young people here, you are building the future. And it's more important, whatever you know is not so important, just use your imagination to do new things. Okay, so I mentioned at the end, because this is of interest to me, an analogy between clocking and relativity. And so using transformation optics. So relativity, you bend light. Einstein's theory of relativity, you bend light by a strong gravitational field, you warp space. We have been able to warp space for electromagnetic waves using transformation optics. So we have a transformation from Einstein to Maxwell. Okay, thank you. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. This can be done for an arbitrary shape, but the transform. So you can do it in. You have to build a transformation that will blow up a point to this, to the shape that you want. Of course, you cannot write it down explicitly. We wrote it down explicitly here, but you can, for instance, build it up numerically. Right? And you can blow up. There are many things that you can try to do. You can blow up a fractal set, right? Because as it will be removable singularity. What comes out from that, I don't know. I don't have any application of it, but you can also try to do it. There are many things you can try to do. You can do an arbitrary shape as long as you can do this transformation. Of course, it's not explicit. The theorem says if you can build this transformation, then it's true. You can also do this in two dimensions, but the interesting application is in three dimensions, of course. Yes? Oh, yes. Yeah, no, that's, of course, many people want to do this. The frequency is the key. Because, as I mentioned before, the larger the frequency, the harder it is to build. So, that is impossible, even theoretically, to build a clock for all frequencies. The theorem says that you can, but under the assumption that the parameters don't depend on frequency, but they do. So, they're lossy. So, what you can do is try many frequencies. If you are going to build a clock, the best thing you're going to do is build it for a band of frequencies. That's what you want to do, for a band. Or for certain type of frequencies, for instance, for planes, radar frequencies. But if you want to beat it, you have to send different type of waves at different frequencies. This is one way. I mean, I'm sure there are others. Fortunately, that you cannot do it for instance. It's very hard. I mean, it's not, nobody can say it's impossible. For X-rays travel in a straight, approximately in a straight line, very high frequency, and it's very difficult to bend them. Fortunately, because otherwise you could hide what, who knows what, from X-rays, that could be problematic. The frequency is the key. That's why it has not been done for light at the scale of a larger scale, say 12 centimeters or something like this, yet. Because light has a higher frequency than acoustic waves or earthquake waves or microwaves. And so the larger the frequency, the harder it is to build these materials. Yes?
Following just now the question about the change, the permittivity or permittivity change of frequency, because in physics, those changes are not arbitrary.
Yes. Of course, there are several models of how the parameters depend on frequency. This is what has been used. Yes, how they depend on frequency, because that will allow you to increase the band. You want to increase as much as possible the band of frequencies for which you want to build this material. But the epsilon and the mu, as you said, depend very specifically on the frequency. Yeah, the causality, that's what I mentioned. You cannot do it for all frequencies. The reason is, even theoretically, because, let me see the picture at the very beginning. This one. Because you want to have the same time to go from one place to the other. There is a delay in time then you will want to see it, it's not invisible. So, but if you bend, then it looks like the speed of light will be, the speed will be higher than the speed of light. You can do this for single frequency or for a band of frequencies, but not for all frequencies, if causality is true. Okay, it's under the assumption that causality is true. I mean, we don't know, right? So you cannot have a speed higher if the in physical terms, the phase velocity can be higher than the speed of light, but not the group velocity, the way transporting energy cannot be higher than the speed of light. So for single frequency or for a band of frequencies, you, in principle, you can, without violating causality. But who knows, maybe causality is not true.
Yeah. Well, guess. So we can the length of the geodesic would be different. Even though it's close, you cannot see it. But if you want to test it, we can test the geodesic, the length of it.
It will be the same. You see, here there is no time. That's why you do the frequency. You're doing this in the frequency domain, right? Yeah, there is no time here.
Device could be set some time, and you can put some device to receive the signal.
Yeah, yeah.
And so if there's nothing in between there.
No, the length of your geodesic will be exactly the same. For this metric, yes.
Okay.
For this metric, which is not for a regular metric, for a remaining metric it will not be true, but for this singular, it's true. It's true. Yes. The length is the same. The length of geodesic is the same. Yeah. I can see that the invisibility attracts much more attention than the visibility. But the visibility is harder, and you want to find things inside, no? Of course, the imagination attracts much more the imagination to make things invisible, but when I talk to my grandson, he only asks me about invisibility. he has no interest in finding what is inside, but want to see how to make things invisible. He keeps asking me whether I have built the clock. So he wants to use it. I don't know for what. Okay. So this afternoon, since I went over time, and there won't be any tutorial. So thanks to him also for his.